This is Tim.
And Brandon.
And this is Deconstructing Comics. Welcome to Deconstructing Comics, sponsored by ComicsNow.com. Before we get to our review today, we received an email from one Larry Young, and he writes, "Thanks for giving so much attention to the Black Diamond. Sorry you guys didn't like the beginning. We trashed the first two issues a few weeks ago. Two things, though. First, obviously you guys aren't downhill skiers, or you'd know the Black Diamond trails are the most challenging and dangerous, and that's where the name of the highway comes from. And second, tell Brandon the car is a 73 Cougar, specifically because it's not a really fine muscle car. It's not even a good Cougar. But I guess the whole thing's full of ironic stuff like that." So, okay. He's very, very gracious in dealing with our criticism, I guess. He even offered us a copy of a different book, Astronauts in Trouble.
Did he offer us a copy of it?
Yeah, he said he'd send a copy of Astronauts in Trouble hardcover.
Oh, really? Mm. Okay. Because that seemed to get a whole lot of really good reviews.
Yeah, well, we'll see.
Yeah, I ordered a copy of that. I didn't know you offered it.
Oh, well, I thought I forwarded you this message, so...
Yeah,
anyway.
You forwarded the first part. I didn't see the last part for some reason. I don't know. Maybe I just didn't read it.
Anyway. So, yes, thanks, Larry Young, for not sending a hit squad after us. Okay.
Well, I do have a couple things to say real quick.
Okay.
Just kind of like, I don't know if you call it theory or not, but I was thinking about his message, and I felt kind of bad because he was so gracious about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought about it, and I was like, well, there's two times, really, that it's really easy to be brutally honest.
Mm-hmm.
And I think for this podcast, I think we mostly operate in one area and not the other. But in the friendship that Tim and Luella and I have, we operate in the other. It's really easy to be brutally honest when you either, one, don't know the person at all,
mm-hmm.
don't anticipate that they'll be listening to the podcast.
Yeah.
Or two, you know the person extremely well, and you're very close to them, and you know that they can handle the criticism.
Yeah.
And between Tim, Luella, and I think when we're looking at each other's work, we operate in that second area where we can be brutally honest with each other, but we know we can take it.
Mm-hmm.
Where in this case, I never anticipated Larry Young listening to the podcast.
Yeah, well, I asked him how he happened to find it. He said, somebody sent me a link to it because they know I like podcasts and probably hoped I'd go nuts or something and talk smack about you all. So,
oh, is that right?
Yeah, that was the second message I got from him.
Okay. That's kind of cool. Yeah, so I was really kind of flattered that he listened to our podcast.
Yeah.
So I think it's really cool, but I also still feel a little bit bad. I mean, I don't want to take anything that I said back. Because I did mean it, and apparently it was kind of valid because you validated it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't catch the irony of it. I'm not sure that I still...
Yeah, I see what he means, but yeah, it's done in such a kind of earnest way that I didn't really catch that there was supposed to be anything ironic about it.
Right, I can appreciate he had a purpose for it now.
Mm-hmm.
At least he had a reason for doing it. And maybe as I become more familiar with him as a writer, maybe I can see that that's where he's coming from. You know, like, you kind of assign a tone to the written word. And if you don't know who the writer is or how that writer usually writes, it's difficult to assign that tone. It was difficult for me to catch that tone, one, because of my familiarity with the work or lack of. And then the second thing is that I think maybe the artwork may have gotten in the way. So the visual element.
Because I was thinking that too.
Are you? Because if you're talking about like a communication where we're face to face and we're just talking to each other, we get like 80% or 90% of the message through what we pick up visually.
Mm-hmm.
Body language, facial expressions, all that kind of stuff. So I'm wondering how much of that was caused by... Now we're going to get a comment from the artist, right?
Probably.
What's the guy's name?
Yeah, I don't have... Actually, I loaned my issues to Cassie, so I don't have it in front of me. Well, I don't recall his name right off, but...
I'm going to be bold, even though I know that Larry is possibly listening. And I'm going to say I still don't like the artwork for the book.
Mm-hmm.
So that could... And really, I guess that would be a big deal, because for the most part, that's going to be the initial impact of a work. A lot of people purchase a book based on, and I know I have in the past.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Purchase a book entirely on the artwork.
Yeah, and no matter how well it's written, the art can really be a turnoff if it's bad. Or turn you off of the whole project.
I think the artist, in this case, was actually somewhat talented with design, because the covers are really kind of cool looking.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't say entirely misleading. So it's not like, you know, you used to, it was a common trick, and I'm sure it still happens today. Like, you would have really popular artists do the cover, like Mike Mignola or something.
Mm.
But the interior would be entirely different, and it would be something that an artist that you really wouldn't like. But the cover artist is the one that sells the book. In this case, John Proctor.
Ah, there we go. John Proctor.
Does a decent job of coming up with an interesting cover in all the books. So it sells. I initially wanted to read the book because of the cover.
Mm.
But, you know, what they say about that.
Can't judge a book by him.
Yeah.
Or a comic book.
Right. The interior is what one needs significant work. So, yeah, I think the artwork may have gotten in the way of the message.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I didn't expect to talk so long about it, but interestingly enough, since we know kind of the way that the comic books are made,
mm-hmm.
I wonder how much, maybe that's one thing we've talked to Larry about, how much of it was actually the way that he intended, you know, because the artist has a big hand in how a story is told. Overall, even if they have a full script in front of them,
mm-hmm.
they can either illustrate it all the way through exactly the way the writer has imagined it, or kind of put their play on it. I know that with Muella's experience and seeing what he goes through with another writer, because mm-hmm. for you and I, it's a little bit different. You know, we put, since we're the creator completely,
mm-hmm.
the writer and the artist, we pull whatever we think goes on the, needs to go on the page.
But yeah, I know Mulele's talked on the podcast before about how what he did with the Weird Crime Theater wasn't what Kumar had envisioned when he wrote it.
And sometimes it's a big struggle for him, because he's trying to weed through what is necessary and what is not.
Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise he would have like 20 panels on a page or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder how much of the way that it's told visually is... What percentage, maybe, is Larry Young, and what percentage is John Proctor?
Mm-hmm.
So as far as the message came across, yeah.
Okay.
That's all I got.
Okay. All right, so our main topic today is Blankets by Craig Thompson. And this won several Harvey and Eisner Awards in 2004. And it's published by Top Shelf, so you know what kind of review we're going to give it.
This book is crap. I'm going to say that just so that I can hopefully get an email from Craig Thompson.
Yeah, that's our new strategy. Yeah, we get creators to contact us by trashing their work in the podcast, whether we actually hate it or not.
Right. Well, it worked once.
Yeah, so this story is really kind of a memoir, and struck me as a brutally honest one. I mean, I'm surprised at the stuff that he put in here that, you know, within the story is stuff that he wouldn't tell anybody.
Or maybe he would, though. We don't know him very well. But a typical person would not.
Well, but I mean, it seemed to me within the story that a lot of the things that happen are things that he was, you know, consciously trying to hide from other people, such as his parents.
Well, I think at the time.
At the time. Yeah, I don't know how old he is now, but although this story seems to take place in the early 90s. Well, and I see the flap here. He was born in 75, so he's just in his early 30s.
He's a year younger than I am.
This is 10 years younger than I am.
My generation. This book is like my high school experience. All summed up. A little variance, but...
In many ways?
In so many ways, it's kind of scary.
Yeah, well, one notable thing about the story is how much of it, I mean, in at the basic level, it's a love story, but also a lot of it has to do with his struggles with religion, with Christianity, and what he felt was expected of him. And I think that's something that Brandon and I have both also faced growing up.
Well, and then add in the whole being an artist and wanting to be a comic book artist into the mix. That's where things get, like, eerily similar. Because I've had people say exactly the same things that were said to me.
Really?
Yeah, from my church.
Wow. So. From your church, no less.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
They told me I shouldn't take art classes.
Did they try to get you to go into the ministry?
They actually did.
Wow.
Sure.
So just everywhere it says Craig, just change it to Brandon, and this becomes your memoir.
Not everywhere. My life isn't identical 100%. Like, some particulars about the relationship were a little bit different. My first girlfriend, it was the setup, the overall ending of the relationship, all extremely similar, but my first girlfriend didn't have near as many problems as his first girlfriend did.
Yeah, she's got a lot to deal with.
Yeah.
I think this is going to be hard to talk about without spoiling it, so maybe we should just tell everybody to go out and buy it and read it first and then listen to the rest of this podcast. But
come back.
And, you know, we're going to recommend it anyway, so there's no suspense about that.
Yeah, the highest recommendation.
Not
just because I like it as far as it being very similar to my own life.
Mm-hmm. And not just because it's published by Top Shelf.
Right. And the artwork is awesome. So, but we'll get into that in a minute. So those of you who don't want to listen, turn off the podcast.
Yeah, I know that's Cassie's strategy. She's waiting to listen to our Persepolis podcast until she finishes reading it. Yeah, so basically this is about him growing up and his situation with his brother and his parents and the church. And then when he's in high school, he goes to church camp and meets a girl there and they basically get infatuated with each other. And then during that winter, he gets an opportunity to live with her family for a couple weeks, to visit her, which is kind of the central part of the story. But she's got a lot of problems. Her parents are breaking up, and they have two adopted retarded siblings. And plus her...
Is that politically correct?
What's a better term?
Mentally handicapped? Down syndrome?
Down syndrome, yeah. Down syndrome. Plus her natural, her blood older sister is kind of hard to deal with. And so she's kind of trying to keep her family together.
She's got all the responsibility in the family.
Yeah, it's just all kind of falling
she
on
takes
her.
Care of her sister's daughter. Is it a daughter?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Plus she takes care of the two siblings, the adopted siblings.
Who are both older than she is.
Her mother relies on her to do all the communication with her father.
Mm-hmm. So she's really kind of clinging to Craig because he's somebody who, you know, she needs to kind of, well, you know, untranslatable Japanese term, amaeru. okay, this is getting into Japanese sociology now, but she kind of needs somebody to cling to, you know, to kind of, you know, not feel like she has to take care of, somebody to take care of her.
But see, this is interesting where I'll pull Larry Young in again. Okay. I can actually see the irony in the relationship because she's pulling him closer because all this stuff, the turbulent time that's going on in her life, but it's also why she's pushing him away at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Where, you know, she's going through this divorce, so she needs somebody to be close to her to kind of reassure her. But mm-hmm. because her parents are going through this divorce, she doesn't believe in relationships long term. Anyway, everything falls apart.
Mm-hmm.
So she can't give herself fully to the relationship at certain times.
Yeah, and other times she's like, you know, never leave me.
Right. She doesn't want him to tell her that she loves him and all that kind of stuff because it's intimidating. She's really ultimately afraid that that's what's happening with her parents is the same thing that's going to happen with them later on.
Yeah, it's understandable.
That's a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah.
It's kind of what happens.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
My limited experience with the girls whose parents have been divorced, it's pretty weird, but that is kind of the way they are.
Mm-hmm.
As a writer, he really captured the characters and the motivating factors. Well, it's obvious. Why wouldn't he?
Uh-huh.
But it shows that he really has a firm understanding of what was going on, at least.
Mm-hmm. And I thought he did a good job of kind of capturing the feeling of, you know, how he was feeling and expressing that in the comic.
Yeah.
Like talking about how cereal was the only thing his stomach could handle because he had those pangs of infatuation. I've been through that. Right after they say goodbye, they meet, their parents drive them halfway and they meet in a country kitchen parking lot, and then they meet there again when he's going back home. And as his mom is driving him out of the parking lot, you turn the page and they've just like fallen off the edge of the earth. And to me, that was the most emotionally affecting page in the book. Just like, wow, that really nails how he's feeling. And he doesn't need a word to express it. Just the picture just carries it.
Right.
It's like, wow, you know, that's exactly how I would be feeling.
Yeah, he does that a lot of different ways in this book.
Mm-hmm.
The expressiveness of his characters, and I don't know, the guy's, it's obvious he's already won awards, but
mm-hmm.
his panel breakdowns, you fall into the story and you can't get out.
Yeah,
I read the first couple pages initially,
mm-hmm.
and I was like, oh, okay. I could probably read this book. But then once I got into, like, maybe 30 pages in,
mm-hmm.
It was over. I couldn't
Couldn't put it down.
Couldn't put it down, no.
Then,
were you going to say something?
I was just going to say, the art style is so kind of fluid. You know, he kind of captures, you know, action and energy in how he draws the figures. And, you know, they're even, you know, the shapes of things. There was one panel somewhere where a door is slammed and it's, you know, a little bit cartoony in how the door bends as it's slamming, just to show that impact, that action. But, you know, even without getting a little cartoony like that, just somehow, you know, every panel, you just kind of feel energy to it.
Yeah. He uses a brush, I think, a lot of the time when he's inking.
Yeah, I think so.
And there's a lot of character to his line. The weight of his line is perfect for what he's trying to illustrate.
Mm-hmm. I wonder what size his actual art is, what size his paper is,
curious.
How much he shrinks it.
Right. It doesn't look like one of those things where he has this huge original with a whole lot of detail, which a lot of comic artists do.
Mm-hmm.
And they shrink it down and it looks... Actually, that was one of my complaints about... what was that space cowboy?
Oh, Fear Agent?
Yeah, Fear Agent was initially like the first couple panels. It looked like it was maybe reduced too much, where the detail was kind of scratchy.
Mm-hmm.
I really like how, in some cases, there's kind of a lack of detail,
mm-hmm.
but it doesn't look like it's been overly reduced, so that it looks like it's perfect. It doesn't have to be perfect. That's what gives each panel even more character, is that you see the kind of roughness of the brush against the paper and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. That's part of the energy that I get out of it.
Right.
It's that roughness.
And you can tell that it was designed to be a black and white book.
Oh,
there
yeah,
lots,
yeah.
Lots of black.
There's too much black to try to color it.
So yeah, even the relationship with his brother was kind of interesting for me, because I have three brothers.
Mm-hmm.
But my youngest brother is probably the closest. And even up into high school, I think, we shared a room.
Mm-hmm.
Initially, we shared the same bed, but he and his brother did.
Yeah, I shared a bedroom with my brother, you know, all growing up, too.
We had bunk beds, so my parents would change the configuration every once in a while. Sometimes we would be on one big bed, and the other times we would actually be on bunks. I don't think they put us into bunks until later on, where they believed that we wouldn't fall out of the bed.
Yeah.
And then it came to a point where I was pulling my brother out of the bed. That's a different story. So I have the same kind of experiences that he had, which I think is really kind of cool, that he pulls not only his relationship with Reyna under that title Blankets, but there's like three parts to it,
mm-hmm.
I think, to the title. Did you catch that as well?
Well, let's see, the Blankets, playing with blankets with his brother, and then the fact that Dana makes a blanket for him.
Yeah.
And what's the third one?
Kind of the blanket of winter, how the height of the relationship was in the snow and that kind of thing.
Okay, sure. Yeah, and then later in the visit, the rough grass starts to show through that blanket as, problems kind of crop up.
Exactly. So the blankets, for the most part, represent like the strength of a relationship for him.
Mm-hmm.
The best times that he had with his brother involved with blankets. Some of the worst times too. But the greatest gift that he got from his girlfriend was that blanket. And then as winter started to subside, that's when he knew their relationship was starting to end. The blanket of winter was gone.
Mm-hmm. But I don't know, to me it wasn't quite clear why he decided to break up with her. I guess the distance was insurmountable, or the trying to deal with all her problems was insurmountable, or you just feel that he'd outgrown it.
It wasn't a matter of outgrowing anything. The way that my relationship with the first woman was pretty much the same. So I, or in this case, Craig really wanted to be in the relationship, but they were just growing more and more distant from each other. And even though he wanted it 100%, it wasn't something that she really wanted, especially when he told her that he loved her, you know, over the phone. And this is already after they both said it to each other. And she said that it was really intimidating the way that he talked, right? So I think part of it is just the lack of proximity. Because they're so far away from each other, it becomes more and more difficult to deal with the relationship. He has a strong, almost addiction to the relationship with her. And he keeps trying to get the relationship back to where it was, while she keeps kind of keeping it at an arm's distance. Even though she's saying certain things every once in a while, it's just not what it was before. So he's got to come to the realization that under the current circumstance, it's never going to be what it was before. And although she wants to be a friend, which is what she really needs him for, she's really kind of pushing him off as a romantic interest.
I guess I felt like his sort of having the strength to decide that he wanted to end it almost felt a little out of character, rather than to just kind of cling to the relationship and, until she dumped him.
You know, I really like this other book. I think I may have told you about it, by Peter David, about writing for comic books. Because one of the things he says in there is, when we're looking at a human character, like if it's real life, human beings always do things that are different than what you would think they would do with it. It's unpredictable. So if we have like upstanding pillar of the community, I think is their example, runs into a person, you would think that if they were written into a book, like if they were in their vehicle in the middle of the night, somebody walks out in the middle of the street and they accidentally hit them, that since they're this upstanding pillar of the community, they would stick around until the cops come around. You know, otherwise you would say, well, that's out of character. But for a human being, that what may be going through that person's mind is, holy crap, I am this upstanding pillar of the community, and everybody's expecting something different of me. I can't get caught for this because it'll just shatter my reputation, even though it's not necessarily that person's fault. So people make decisions that on a daily basis that may counter what everybody thinks is their character. Where in a book, we're expecting the characters to make those same decisions in the same way, in the same manner, in order to call it their character. In this case, since it's autobiographical, one, it's not a fictional character that we would have to say, well, he's got to make the same kind of decisions in order for us to understand who his character is.
Yeah, but he's apparently chronicling things that actually happened.
So if we're looking at a real depiction of a real life event, then the whole idea of establishing a character that is entirely consistent doesn't play with an autobiography. And in addition to that, simply because my experience is similar to his, I can completely see why his character made the decision that he made. Because his character was so emotionally involved with her, and because he was being held off at a distance because of her lack of faith in relationships overall, it becomes more and more painful for him every time that he talks with her. Even though he's doing his best to be a really good friend to this girl, every moment that he isn't in that space that they were in before, it compounds itself because he really wants it to be, but he's trying to be noble and he's doing his very best to meet her needs, but his needs aren't getting met.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can say it really in almost any relationship. You get to the point where one person's needs aren't getting met,
mm-hmm.
it changes the relationship. It changes even how they see each other in
mm-hmm.
the relationship.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, like, if my needs or your needs aren't getting met in a romantic relationship, a person that we may have seen as like an angel, the perfect person in that relationship, can start to look more like a devil in the end.
Mm-hmm.
Because whatever you're trying to pull out of that relationship isn't getting satiated. It's basic psychology, I guess.
Ma'am.
But I've been where he is, so I mean, I completely understand why he just kind of said, well, let's stop here.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else that you wanted to discuss about this?
Yeah, my brother never peed on me.
That's good. Neither did mine. And I never peed on him either.
Well, we did fight over the blankets and that kind of thing. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I could see the personal... it's kind of cool that a lot of the really intimate relationship that he has with his brother comes through in their time where they're kind of stuck together. I think it's really cool that his brother was an artist too.
Because
I didn't really have that with my brother. But it would have been cool. Anything to say? I guess that was all kind of the story, the writing side. We already talked about the art, huh?
Damn.
Even though it's kind of a cartoony,
mm-hmm.
Raiden is pretty sexy, isn't she?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I fell in love with her right away.
Yeah.
It's that fluidity of the line again, too, I think, is part of it.
Well, and the simplification of the character, too. He's chosen the right way to draw the line for that character.
Mm-hmm.
It's very similar to, like, how... I'm not crying, by the way. I just have a running nose. There's something in my eye. Something in both my eyes. Robinson. Alex Robinson. The way he draws some of those characters.
Hmm.
You know, they're really cartoony, but ultimately, there's some that you find really, really attractive.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. And Tricked. What's her name? Lily. Boy, did I have a crush on her.
Oh, yeah?
Nothing like having a crush on a fictional character. Talk about distance.
What's really kind of adds to the whole eeriness of the story to me is that, one, it is really in my generation. The whole grunge movement was right at the tail end of high school for me.
Mm.
And I met my first girlfriend at camp.
Mm-hmm.
And then we lived far apart, so it was a long distance relationship, just like his was.
Mm-hmm.
I actually stayed the night at her house one weekend.
Hmm.
It wasn't a whole week.
Wow.
It was a couple weekends, but it was the same kind of thing. And I was extremely religious. I had all those people saying the same kind of things, so it was wow.
This is your life.
This is my life. Yeah. Part of me was thinking, you know, I really need to, like, email the guy and tell him how much this thing meant to me. But I don't know that it would matter, because he's extremely successful, so I don't know if he would appreciate that or just think I'm some creepy stalker guy.
Some groupie. Some fanboy. Some hanger-on.
Yeah. Because I guess with this book and, well, probably this book more so than the others, he's gotten a whole lot of critical acclaim for it, right?
Mm-hmm. 3 Harvey Awards and 2 Eisner Awards.
And he does another book while he's traveling in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Because they've invited him to different conventions and things because of this book, Blankets.
Say that again?
So, there's another book out there that he did while he was traveling in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why he was in Europe was because of this book, Blankets. They had invited him to a bunch of different events.
I see.
So I would say that this book has made him extremely successful.
Mm-hmm.
I remember seeing it at the Comic-Con when I went in 2005. And I guess he was there behind the table, but I hadn't read it yet.
You may not have recognized him if you saw him.
No, he looks pretty much like the guy in the picture.
Well, maybe we could try to get him on the podcast, which leads me to mention two weeks from when you hear this episode, in other words, our November 5th episode will be, first of all, it'll be the 100th episode of Deconstructing Comics, but it will also, it'll feature my interview with Phil Dunlap, who does a comic strip called Inkpen, which is in about 50 newspapers. It'll be the first time that we've had someone on the podcast who's actually had, well, besides Mulele, who's actually had some like success with comics. I've already recorded the interview. I asked him, you know, some kind of creator questions and some things, you know, sort of fanboy questions about Inkpen, since I'm a fan of that strip. But I'd like to interview some more creators in the future. You know, through Skype, you know, I can call a telephone and can track down pretty much anybody if we can deal with the time difference. But or if you want to do it, you're in New Jersey, you don't have to deal with the time difference.
Yeah, Kevin Smith's from New Jersey, right?
Maybe.
So yeah, Kevin Smith is from New Jersey.
Okay.
The three biggest films that he did are called the Jersey Trilogy.
Was that, that's including Clerks?
Clerks, Chasing Amy, and, Amazon has it bundled.
Mm.
In Canada, Kevin Smith, the New Jersey Trilogy. It consists of Clerks, Mallrats, and Chasing Amy. Mallrats is the one I forgot.
Mallrats,
and these are stories that are exclusively set in New Jersey, and New Jersey is central to the storytelling.
Okay, well, call him up.
Yeah, right. Hey, dude. How's it going?
Who knows? He might be listening to our podcast.
Well, we need to say something bad about him.
Yeah, exactly.
He has a mullet. No, I can't say anything bad about Kevin Smith.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I did want to say, before I got interrupted by the lawnmower. So this 100 episodes, huh? That's a pretty big deal. Is that why you reserve this interview?
Well, that's the first reason, and the second reason is it gives me a chance to try to figure out, you know, set up a little bit of marketing for it.
So I'm not good enough to be on the 100th episode. Is that what you're saying?
Sorry. I wish that we all could have all three. I wish that we could have all three interviewed him, but that would have been a logistical nightmare.
No, I'm good. I'm just messing with
you. I know.
I don't see anything. Well, Wikipedia isn't all the know-alls. They all, but
it's not.
Anything about Black Diamond as far as skiing? Let me look it up again.
Mm. Well, Cassie seemed to be familiar with that term.
I see. Black diamonds are the color of the symbols used to mark advanced ski trails. Black diamond ski trails are often difficult to ski and have an advanced terrain. The peak of Copper Mountain has many black diamond ski trails.
I see. Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, so that's not bad. Completely off topic. You'll have to move that one to the front of the podcast.
Don't forget to visit our sponsor, comicsnow.com. Get 30% off all your books or 35% off if you subscribe. And Comics Now provides Eric's newsletter, which is on our site, globalcomics.net. And also on Global Comics, I've set up a little place where if you feel so inclined, you can give us a donation. help us defer all the many costs of of doing this podcast. Yeah, right. We've been doing some advertising, so
we'll work for comic books.
So the Phil Dunlap interview is in 2 weeks. Next week I'll be talking with Mulele about some as yet undetermined topic. So
said hi.
Okay.
I haven't emailed him yet. You said I had to email him first, right?
Yeah, you did.
That hasn't happened. I apologize. Probably not gonna happen.
Okay. Anyway, so this is Tim.
And Brandon.
See you next week on Deconstructing Comics.
So long, Superman. I'm taking a vacation. I'll miss your medication. It helped to ease the pain.